and your company's name again?
The name of the publishing house is 85 Comics.
All right, thanks. I want to make sure it was pronounced right, because I use technology for visually impaired people, and things get mispronounced every so often.
Oh, I understand that.
Yep. So, is that the new publishing house for dragontrio?
Yes, it is. It's actually when my relationship with Insane Comics ended a few back, almost going on a year now, back this past November. I decided that I was going to publish it myself. It came about is just a way to publish my comic and my partner's comic, but it's kind of just started to grow and gain popularity. So at this moment, we're publishing about five different titles from other creators, and we're looking to probably have that double by the time the year ends. So it's picking up some steam, and I'm enjoying learning the business side of it as well. So.
Yeah, I saw that thing you put on Facebook that, you know, you're not doing, have to do all the boring stuff.
I'm sorry, say that again?
I said I saw that post you put up about you now have to do all the boring stuff.
Oh, yeah. Because then it's not just about drawing a comic. You have to learn the printing side of it. You have to learn the keeping inventory and sending out invoices. Pretty much the whole business side of it. And while I'm still kind of green about it, still new at it, I'm getting used to it, you know.
Cool. So are you guys in the previews yet or no?
No, we're not in previews yet. That's another goal for us this year, as well as trying to work our way into some retailer shops. Right now, you can get our comics through digital download, or you can go to inkpotcomics.webs.com, and you can actually purchase the comic from our web store, and of course have it shipped out pretty much anywhere in the country.
Great, because I'm just getting back in the swing of things after 4.5 months of going to a school for the visually impaired, trying to figure out, what's going on with some of my peeps who supported the podcast over the last 2 years.
Okay.
How come, are you a bit of the same while you and, James parted ways, or?
Well, it was one of those things where it was more of a mutual parting, so there was nothing involved where there was any hard feelings or anything. I wasn't very happy, and, I was really looking to kind of get out of the contract anyway, but, when he brought it to me and said, hey, we're looking at maybe redoing some things, and, how do you feel about staying on, and do you want to part ways, or what do you want to do, and so we decided mutually that that was probably the best thing, because it's one of those things where I enjoyed my time with Insane, but there was a lot of things, like, for instance, I felt like with the celebrity endorsements that I was getting and all of that, that legwork was all me. So I felt like that if I was gonna do all the legwork with the advertising and all of that, then I should be the one to reap the profit. And see, what we're doing with Inkpot is we're not looking to be the publisher, the kind of publisher, not saying that that's what Insane does, but we're not looking to be the kind of publisher that takes more than half, 60 or 70% of a creator's money. There's a lot of great talent out here, and we're just trying to help people get their stories out. And I figure that as long as I can recoup my printing costs, then I'm fine. Then whatever else the book makes goes to the creator. I'm not trying to kill the creator's pocket. They did all the work, so I feel like they should reap the benefits, which is the way I felt when I decided to start Inkpot.
That's awesome. And outside of Dragon Trio, which we'll get to in a minute, what other books is in the Inkpot family?
Well, we have a couple of one-shots there. We have the Path in the Wind series, which is a sequel to another book that me and Terrence Baker, the founder of ICC, did a couple of years ago called The Wind and the Wolf. And it's kind of a spin-off with Dragontrio a little bit, because it goes into the story of the female villain that has become so popular, so she garnered her own spin-off title. So we have that, and we have a couple of books by Alan McMillian. He's a fantastic creator. He has a kind of a detective crime drama story called Caught in the Web. And it's about an award detective who, when he starts, it's kind of a mystery thing where he starts investigating the murder of this young couple in his home, in their home, and things get weird. It's kind of a Twilight Zone crime drama kind of thing. And he's got another book called The Alicia Chronicles, and it's kind of more in there. It goes off in a whole other direction. It's more of that fantasy, kind of Lord of the Rings type title, and it's basically about a centuries-long war between two races of this land called Alicia. So that's a pretty good one. Let's see, we have my partner, Michael Armstrong, his Rise of the Dragon, that's coming out later this year as well. We've got a brand new, we've got Future Shock number one, which is Shandor Wilson, and he is, Future Shock's more the quintessential superhero type book. So we got something for everybody at EPOP. We got one of our first manga books is, by an artist named Kay Minami, and she's been writing Dark Soul, and that's going to be ultimately like the 80 chapter manga that we're bringing out. So, everybody, any pops.
That's awesome. And you're still also currently accepting submissions?
Yes, we are. And we're actually always looking to add to our lineup. I mean, something, it's one of those things where we had so many for a while, we had to shut it down, but we're looking at getting ready to open them back up within the next week or so, so that we can start planning out what books are going to be coming out. So we can start looking at some stuff that's going to be coming out in 2018. Because right now, what we've got scheduled for release, we've got up through, I think, maybe February or March, so we're going to be looking at some stuff soon to keep going past that.
What's the procedure to submit something to Inkpot?
Well, there's a page on our website, inkpotcomics.webs.com, and there's a submissions tab. And under that, you click on that, and it'll basically tell you what we would like to see, because we like to see a minimum of 5 completed pages of artwork and the scripts. And what we do is we basically make our determination from that. We're not genre specific, and we don't say, okay, well, it's gotta be superhero, that's all we publish, or it's gotta be this, or it's gotta be that. We're open to any kind of genre. The only thing that we will absolutely say no to, of course, it's gotta be a quality standard, but because we're getting to the point now where we can be a little selective about what we pick. But the only thing that we will absolutely say no to, I don't care how well it's drawn and produced, if there's absolutely nothing blatant, no blatant pornography or anything like that, obviously, and nothing excessive violence. I mean, we understand that we're doing action books, so violence is fine, but excessive violence, especially anything of a domestic nature or anything like that, we have to say no to that kind of stuff, because there are instances where children may be reading these books. So,
That's fair enough, and I was asking that for, you know, not just for my audience, but for myself, because right now I'm just at the concept phase where I'm looking for an artist for an idea that I have.
Gotcha.
Okay. But I may respectively have to pass with Inkpot, because my concept may be a little, even though it's not porn, it may still be a little bit more on the adult nature.
Okay. Well, and it's funny you should mention that. I was about to say that, well, you know, we realize that not every comic book is for children to read, just like every video game is not for every child to play.
Yeah.
So we realize that. And what we're thinking about doing is going into 2018. You know how the video games have a rating system?
Yep.
And M for mature, T for teen. We're thinking about implementing something like that with our comic books as well. So let parents know that, hey, this comic book may not be one that you want your 10-year-old daughter reading, or, you know, for a kid. So, you know, we're gonna look into doing that as a kind of a way to indemnify ourselves, but, you know.
That's awesome. I think that's something I wish a lot more of the indie publishers would do.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, so I'm gonna be setting up at my first convention as a dealer in a couple weeks.
Yeah.
And I'm just trying to think of if someone young, you know, it's hard to recommend things for younger kids now.
Right. What convention are you doing?
It's just a small convention in Clifton, New Jersey.
Okay.
It's just like a straight up comic book show. With just vendors. But I've known the promoter like my entire adult life, so.
Okay.
I think it was a good place to get my feet wet again.
That's great. I'll tell you what. As a vendor, you'll love it. We've done. I've gotten into what I've done my first couple of shows as a vendor. We did in the Blues Con here in Memphis. That's an annual one here in Memphis every summer. We did that one back in July, and we also did Memphis Comic Expo.
How was that?
How was which one?
The Expo.
Oh, Memphis Comic Expo. It was fantastic. We had a great time. We made a lot of connections. We moved some merchandise. But the main thing is we made a lot of connections. We had a lot of people stop by our table. And that's what you want us. And that's mainly what it's about. I think a lot of people go into a convention as a vendor with the wrong mentality. If you think that you're going to walk out of there with money that's falling out of your pocket, it typically doesn't happen like that. Very few times would you ever actually make back or even break even with what you put into the convention. But, you know, as long as you know that it's not about that, it's about getting out there, getting your name out there, it's about making connections. We had a great time. We met some artists. We got to talk with Jerry King Waller.
Nice.
We had a great time. We even had a local cosplayer here portray the assassin in the Dragontrio. So
was that the cosplayer that brought up all the controversy that you were talking about a couple of weeks ago?
I'm sorry?
Was that the cosplay picture, the cosplayer that
brought up all the
bull crap?
Yes, her name is Canalia Clay, and she actually did a really fantastic job for it, and it was something that she did pretty much out of pure graciousness, so we're forever grateful to her for that. That's her hobby. She helps run an organization called Cosplay, CAUSE.
Uh-huh.
And it's where these cosplayers, they all dress up as various characters, and they go in and entertain children at party, St. Jude, all kinds of places.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah, so she's a really sweet lady, her and her whole family, and they were just really supportive of us. They've been really supportive of me since it started. So, you know, that's kind of what you want to do. You want to surround yourself with people that can help you reach what you're trying to do.
Yeah, like I said, my first thing is I'm just trying to get more ears to the podcast or more eyes to the podcast and, buy and sell some comics, put some extra money in my pocket, you know?
I understand that. That's definitely a way to do it, to get it out there, man. There's a ton of ways you can do that. Besides YouTube, I mean, I would probably look into getting a spot on one of these blog websites where you can upload the episode every week, because that's specifically geared towards people who watch podcasts, and I bet you a lot of people watch or listen to podcasts, and a lot of people, I bet you, would pick it up.
Yeah, I'm starting to get more involved with a couple of different comic book blogs and a couple of different venues. So, one step at a time.
Baby steps.
Yep. Right now I want to smack Neil Gaiman. I got American Gods and Braille, and I got a mountain of Braille books that I'm looking at each and every day.
That's cool. Well, I'll tell you, like I said, when you get ready and you feel like you have everything ready with your book, definitely check in, find out. We're always looking to expand our lineup and bring the next good independent comic book
to now?
Dragontrio is up to issue number 4 right now. Issue number 4 is getting ready to wrap up and go to the printer. And my hope is that I can get it to the printer by November for a December release. So that's my hope. I do definitely want to get a new issue out because a new one has not dropped since number 3, which was back earlier in the year, maybe February or so of the year. And I want to get another one out within that same calendar year. So we're on number 4, and then there's going to be no break. We're rolling straight into number 5, and once we finish 5, it's going to round out the first story up. After that, it's trade paperback time, so
nice.
We may take a little break before we go into the second story up.
That's awesome. I also noticed that you got a couple new endorsements, since the last time we spoke, which has been about a year now.
Yeah, we've got a couple of new endorsements here. I managed to get one from Daniel Pacina, and he is, if you don't know who he is, he's a martial artist, but he was an integral part of the success of the Mortal Kombat video game franchise. In fact, in the first 2 games, I think he played the original Scorpion, Sub-Zero, and Johnny Cage. So I was able to get him. I was able to get John Parrish, who played the original Jax. One of the ones I'm really waiting on now, and I understand that he's filming in Canada, so he got word to me that he'll attend to him once he gets back, is Michael Jai White. So that's the one that I'm really waiting on
nice.
To grab, and I hope, you know, I've said he's doing a film project in Canada, and he let me know, but, you know, a couple weeks ago he called me and told me, he messaged me and told me that he did get them, and the books I sent him, and he'll definitely attend to him when he gets back. So that's going to be a big deal for me because I'm a huge fan of his.
So am I.
I'm a huge fan of just about everybody that I love that's been gracious enough to do this. You know, that's a big honor for me, is because I started out as fans of every last one of these guys first.
I can relate to that because I was at New York Comic Con running an errand for my brother who couldn't make it. And I actually got to interview Rob Paulson, and he did almost the entire interview as Pinky. This is like my inner fanboy was just like, this is awesome.
Yeah, that is also very nice. While we were at the expo, we got a chance to catch up with got a chance to meet Walter Jones. Of course, I know, you know, that's the original Black Power Ranger. So, got a chance to meet and chat with him as well. Also, really cool guy.
He's awesome, dude.
We'll have some fun at this convention as a vendor. I mean, they're fun to go to again, but they're a lot of fun to go to as a vendor. So, you'll have a blast.
Cool. What's this I've been seeing in your Facebook feed about you taking bumps?
I'm sorry, Adam. You went real low there.
What's up with you taking bumps in the wrestling school lately?
Oh, my God, yeah. Well, the way that came about is, of course you know me, I've been a fan of wrestling pretty much all my life. There's a local federation down here in Memphis called Real South Wrestling Federation, or RSWF for short. And it started out with me and my family just go to the shows every week, and they have a free show on Thursday nights, and then they have a paid one on Saturdays. And the free show is to just kind of showcase their students and, you know, what they're learning and all of that, and the Saturday show is to show the more advanced wrestlers. But one night after a Thursday show, me and a buddy of mine just decided to, we were hanging out in the arena after everything, and we just got up in the ring and started horsing around, kind of remembering our days. We used to participate in a backyard federation when we were teenagers. So we got in the ring and we just kind of started horsing around and kind of reliving our childhood a little bit. And I guess we knew enough to where it looked like we knew what we were doing, enough to where the promoter gets up the PA system and he said, "Hey, if you guys want trains, come back to the back and see me." So we wound up doing that, and the next day, they're actually showing me how to fall in a ring. Now, I'll tell you one time spread the impact out.
Yeah.
So I went down one time and I didn't have that chin tucked in, I didn't have the chin tucked too well, and I went down one time and my neck did a kind of a whiplash thing. And I felt that for about 2 weeks.
Actually, as soon as I saw you post the whiplash thing, I said, I bet you didn't put his chin down.
Yeah, and that's one thing that he told me. He said, when you go down, you got to make sure you have that chin tucked so that your neck doesn't flop around. So I learned that the hard way. And once I started doing it a little more, I went down, I kept going down, I kept going down. I mean, he made me take probably about 50 bumps at one time. And he's like, you're going to keep taking them until you get tired. And by the time I got done, which was like maybe 50, I was, I started getting the hang of it because I'm like, wait a minute, I didn't feel that one as much. You know, the first couple times you do it, it's going to knock the wind out of you. But as I started to keep going down, I was like, okay, I don't feel it as much. My back, which is what I was falling on, wasn't sore at all. It was just that one time I went down and I didn't have that head tucked down too well. So I paid for that.
Yeah.
Like they've been showing us how to collar and elbow tie up and how to hit the ropes. That's another thing that a lot of people probably don't think hurts, but it does.
Yeah, it hurts.
Yes, it hurts. It's very much. I think I came home and I took my shirt off and I turned on the mirror and I had a big welt right under my arm from hitting the top rope. And that's another thing he made me do over and over. He's like, you're going to run the ropes until you get tired. So, until you're literally about to pass out. So, after about 40 times hitting the ropes, I'm like, oh my God, I don't know if I love this as much. I don't know if I love this as much anymore. But I actually do, and I plan on going back to him to get trained, finish getting training. I've got to get some financial things lined up, because he doesn't charge much to train you, but he does charge, so I've got to get some financial things lined up. And I figure maybe after that I can maybe be a heel manager for the organization, maybe be somebody's Bobby Heenan or somebody's...
Yeah, I can see you being a good heel.
Yeah, maybe be somebody's Bobby Heenan or somebody's Paul Heyman or something.
Yep. Just because we know each other when we're not doing podcasts, and I see your posts, I'm like, he would make a great heel. But you said that you would make a great heel.
I think it'd be just more fun to be a heel. To me, it's just more fun to be a heel. You know, you come out and you kind of get some cheap heat off the crowd. And I just think it'd be a lot more fun to do that.
Yeah, same here.
Yeah, so.
So you watching current product now, or?
I'm sorry?
Are you watching current product now?
You mean from WWE and from wrestling?
Yeah.
I've been keeping up with it a little more than I have been in the last few years. I'm going to check out TLC tomorrow and see what winds up happening with that. The women's division are really focusing on. One thing I hate, I think Nia Jax is getting ready to part ways, which I hate because I really like her, so.
Yeah, actually, I can see her going the global force.
Which sucks to me because I really like her, you know?
Yep, that means, I watch more Global Force, a lot more Ring of Honor right now.
Right. Somebody was telling me I should check out, Ring of Honor, because, if you like good, pure wrestling without a lot of the theatrics, Ring of Honor may be more for you, you know? So I'm going to check them out.
Yep, Global Force is more this generation's ECW at this point.
Yeah.
I'm just getting back into watching WWE after a year. I haven't watched it since Mania.
Yeah.
So,
I took a bit of a heyday hiatus for watching after WrestleMania, too. My thing is, I always said that when Taker retired, I probably would take a little bit of a break from it. So, when Roman Reigns retired again at WrestleMania, I took about a 2 or 3 month break from watching any of it.
Yeah, I actually caught the highlights on YouTube, and now I'm intrigued with the Shield being reunited, so.
Yeah, I am too. I think that something has happenings. I don't know if Roman is hurt or has he violated the wellness policy again or what, but he won't be wrestling at TLC tomorrow night. And they're going to replace him with Kurt Angle.
Ooh.
Kurt Angle's going to wrestle for the first time in 11 years in a WWE ring.
That sounds like a wellness violation.
Yeah, so that's going to be interesting to see. So.
Yeah. You know, just got to be careful. That's strike two for him.
Yeah, I know. I think he's got a bad neck or something.
No, that could be it, too. You see anything cool comic book movie-wise lately?
Comic book movies, I haven't really... of course, I saw Wonder Woman, which I thought was absolutely great.
That was the bomb.
Probably the best comic book movie I've seen in a long time, and I've seen a lot of comic book movies. It's probably the best one I've seen in a long time. I am psyched, super psyched for Justice League next month, so I might be checking that one out.
Then I
will. Yeah, I saw bits and pieces of Suicide Squad. I might get rigged on the coast with it, but I wasn't as impressed with it as everybody else was.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a fun movie if you like the characters. If you're looking for it to make any kind of sense or to be comic book accurate, don't bother.
Right. I wasn't as impressed with it as I guess. Well, I mean, I'm not saying it was a horrible movie. So I wasn't as impressed with it. But Wonder Woman, I absolutely loved. It was a fantastic movie. I think since I've bought it, I've probably watched it about six times already.
I've seen it twice. And I'm actually going to go check out the bio movie, too.
Very cool. Very cool.
So they did that William Monster bio movie that I want to check out.
Very nice.
And like I said, everything is awesome. I'm just starting to catch up on all my shows now. There's like way too many of them nowadays.
Yeah, there's way too many to even keep up with nowadays.
Yep.
I've kind of been keeping up with Supergirl, but I stopped at the second season, episode one, where her and Superman save the plane. I kind of stopped there, so I got to pick back up on that.
Yeah, actually, Supergirl season two is amazing. I'm really digging Gifted right now, the new X-Men show. I think it's to that action what the original animated shows was to animation. It's better than the last couple of movies combined.
Okay, yeah.
With the exception of Logan.
That's actually been pretty good. I've been meaning to catch up with all that stuff. Like I said, Supergirl and Wonder Woman. And I've been meaning to, like I said, I'm going to check out Justice League. But I got so many shows to catch up on. I mean, Flash, Gotham, I haven't even been really watching any of that stuff.
Yeah, I'm just starting to get back in the swing now, too. As always, I thank you for the support of the podcast. And I thank you for our friendship, man.
Absolutely, no problem, man. I'm sorry about giving you the run around a couple of times.
No, I totally understand. I told you, no harm, no foul.
Get off in a decent hour, and every time I was scheduled, it's like, I gotta work late again tonight. So man, I didn't mean to keep blowing you off or anything like that.
Last night worked out perfectly because I was able to get another episode out of just doing reviews and, you know, other stuff I haven't gotten to yet, so it worked out perfectly, man.
Well, that's good, man. I'm glad I'm able to help. Like I said, anytime you want me on, just shoot me a message, just let me know.
Hey, man. Thank you so much, and I'll get this to you ASAP.
All right, Adam. Thanks a lot, buddy. Take care.
Wilson.
Bye now.
Bye. Next time. Stop recording video.